श्रुतिस्मृतिपुराणानां आलयं करुणालयं नमामि भगवत्पादशंकरं लोकशंकरं। डियर प्रोफेसर पांडुरंग भट्ट, माय क्लोज फ्रेंड, वी वर टुगेदर, वी स्टडीड इन विवेकानंद कॉलेज इन मद्रास यूनिवर्सिटी. He is the chief guest of the day. Sri K. Narayanan Poti, a renowned Vedic scholar and a scholar in several disciplines, who is in the helm of affairs of the Kandalur Shala as president. Sri S. Madhavan Nambudri, again an engineer, like a scientist, an engineer, who is the vice president of the, he is also a very good scholar in Yajurveda, Sri Madhavan Nambudri. Sri G. Ramamurthy, who is the academic director of Kandalur Shala. Dr. K.K. Hariharan, the administrative director of the Kandalur Shala. Last but not the least, who is man behind of this program, our treasurer, Dr. Pradeep Jodi, the learned participants on this virtual platform of Kandalur Shala. I extend my warm welcome to all of you. Today we have, as told by our beloved secretary, that this is the third lecture in the series, the Indian intellectual tradition. We have another series of lecture, and we have an international lecture series, and we have several workshops, we have several colloquiums. Some are we have already done, some are in the pipeline, and we have several courses also. 2-3 courses we have already launched on Vedas, Vedic literature, especially on Brahmanas, Kaushitaki Brahmanas, Brahmana, and Aitareya Aranyaka. One year diploma, PG diploma, and another certificate course for 6 months. And we have a Vastu Vidya, Indian architecture, one course that is for 3 years. So that is in collaboration with Sthapatya Veda Vidyapeetha at Calicut, under the direction of Professor Balagopala Prabhu. Now, entering into the core theme of today's lecture, I am very happy that we are exploring one after another the areas of study where we need some inter-dialogue or face-to-face dialogue between ancient and modern wisdom. If you go through our epics, epic Mahakavyas, especially in Mahabharata, you will come across abundantly several very serious references about the leadership. In the present invitation, we have given a quotation from Mahabharata, from Bhishma Parvan, or from Shanti Parvan, that Bhishma speaks his words. The leader's happiness is in the happiness of his followers, and the followers' well-being is the leader's well-being. A true leader sets aside his personal needs and identifies with the followers' needs. It's a very, very, very significant quotation from Mahabharata. How a leader should be. Our vision of our ancestors, our ancient gurus. The leadership quality depends on three major things. Three major foundation stones of this leadership is concept, competence, and connectivity. These three, avoiding these three, you cannot build a perfect leadership. A leader, first and foremost, he should be calm. He's a calm person. He remains unruffled in all situations. The Sanskrit word for an unshakable person is akshobhya. The imperturbable person, unshakable person, akshobhya. When you are undisturbed, you will bring out the best in you. Every problem comes with its own solution. The solution also takes birth along with the problem. The solution is hidden in the problem. When you are akshobhya, you are able to see the problem as an opportunity. Each problem is an opportunity to prove your mettle. Let me distinguish between a reaction and a response. A reaction is an uncontrollable response, an uncontrolled response. Whereas a response is a controlled reaction to situations. In response, you are a master, and in reaction, you are a slave of the environment. A leader is able to distinguish between reaction and response. In the Bhagavad Gita, Krishna's first advice to Arjuna is to keep cool. Gadasun agadasumsa nanashochanti panditaha. Meaning, wise people do not get upset over events past or present. Arjuna was very much upset and disturbed in the battlefield of Kurukshetra because he found it difficult to fight with his own people, uncles and grandfathers who were on the opposite side. He threw down his weapons, saying that he did not want to fight. He wanted to run away into the forest. It was an uncontrolled reaction, what the psychologists might call a flight response. Arjuna was extremely disturbed, vikshubdha. Krishna's advice to Arjuna was to remain cool. That is his first advice and foremost advice. Haven't you heard that expression, be cool, man? All over the world, wherever you go, they say, be cool, take a breath, have a drink, be cool, and then look at the problem. Andha shitalata, that is inner coolness, is an important value, has an important value in the Indian wisdom tradition. A leader should never be agitated. A leader can never be overpowered by events. You may call it coolness, self-confidence, faith in God. Several people take it in a different way, but all these things put together, it is coolness inside. Faith in God or faith in oneself. Atma Pratyaya. A cool frame of mind is infectious. when such a person comes into a group, everybody feels cool and quiet. When you are cool and quiet, the best of responses come out of you, because then you get access to resources within yourself. Once you are upset, you will not get any your control inside your powers. You lie inside. We have that creative potential within ourselves, but because of the disturbed state of our mind, we are not able to tap into that reservoir of intelligence and energy. Hence, Krishna told Arjuna to remain cool. In the Indian culture, any teaching or conference begins with a prayer invoking that peace. Om Shanti Shanti Shanti. Peace be, peace be, peace be. Whereas a political meeting starts with a cry, Krandi, 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 like that. Violence. Krandi is nothing but violence. Unholy elements try to catch fish in the troubled waters. Any idea can be sold to an agitated crowd. Any idea can be sold out to any agitated crowd. An agitated crowd is generally dumb. They exhibit only the lowest common factor in human nature. Therefore, be cool and be the master of your world. Shankaracharya, the Dayan of Indian philosophy and a great Vedantic teacher, we have several Vedantic teachers. There is a line in that lineage, he is a crystal jewel. He said a leader should be like a lion, and he should be like an ocean. He two places he gives in a two different way. If you put a stone into the ocean does not overflow, nor gets muddied, nor disturbed. Whereas if you put a stone into a puddle, not only does the puddle overflow, but it gets muddied, and you are not able to see the bottom. So similarly, a wise man or a great and a genuine leader is never disturbed by the circumstances. He remains calm like an ocean, Akshobhya, as I told you earlier. Like Mahatma Gandhi, who was at the center of the storm as he led the mighty movement for independence. Fighting against the most powerful colonial nation, in spite of all the troubles and the turmoil, he sat calmly in his tiny room in Ahmedabad, spinning the charkha with great concentration. He forgot everything else and concentrated on the work at hand. After this meditation, he moved into the political potpourri, Congress, the working committee meetings with Mountbatten or Jinnah or Patel or what we call Nehru, whoever may be, all the while keeping his cool nature. Another important quality of a leader is his ability to give attention to diverse aspects of a problem. Those aspects may be contradictory and may not have anything in common with each other, but still he is able to do that because of his inner quiet, inner silence, inner shanti. When you are not disturbed by the situation and you are actively engaged in the challenges of the day, you are able to emerge stronger and offer unique solutions to the problems. You don't have to read a book to find the solution. When you read a book, you are reading only old solutions. That is the fun of it. We read the books, but we read only the old things. Problems are constantly changing, and old situations will not be applicable to new situations. A leader has to offer innovative solutions to new challenges. A leader needs that power, that spontaneity, the innovativeness. Otherwise, he can become maximum a consultant. He will not be a reader. He can be qualified as a consultant. All failed business leaders, what we see in around the world, they become failed business people, failed business leaders. They become advisors. They become consultants. I heard this funny story. There was a person who was struggling to sleep. He read lots of books on how to get good sleep. The more he read, the more sleepless he became. Ultimately, he ended up writing a bestseller, a book, The Art of Sound Sleep. Anybody who read the book fell asleep immediately. But unfortunately, the author himself was still sleepless. Going back to the past is not the solution. Only if you critically review the past with a contemporary mind, take out the nuggets, you will be successful. Otherwise, you will be lost in the labyrinth of the past. That is not what we need in the present day. We do not have the time or the leisure for that. We need immediate solutions to contemporary issues, problems. After the Mahabharata battle, Arjuna, who won the battle and the kingdom, and was in a relaxed mood, asked Krishna to repeat the Bhagavad Gita once more, to hear it in a calm, with a calm mind. In the battlefield, he was not calm. So he wanted to know more about it. Then he asked Krishna to repeat the Bhagavad Gita once more. Arjuna confessed that he had not been paying adequate attention to Krishna's teaching in the battlefield, as arrows were flying, disturbing his concentration. Now he was relaxed and requested Krishna to repeat the profound philosophy, Bhagavad Gita. But Krishna told, "Oh Arjuna, I never repeat. If I teach you the same Gita now, I will be teaching something new, something else. My teaching was for the specific action, for a specific situation. Hence, a good leader never repeats." That is a very prominent advice given. He is the best leader. Krishna is the best leader. He is called Jagat Guru. He is always original. He is always unique. Mahatma Gandhi could capture the leadership of the freedom movement from stalwarts like Motilal Nehru, Gokhale, Tilak, and so many people because of his unique style of leadership. They were all living in marble palaces, all these leaders, speaking in English and dressing up like Englishmen, Mahatma Gandhi came dressed up like a villager in a loincloth and talked in Gujarati, local Gujarati. He spoke the language of Satyagraha. He introduced new idioms and symbols and metaphors and could communicate with the people through those means. India, being a multilingual country, has the problem of not being able to understand one another through language. We have to have some way of communication, and that has to come from symbols. India is a country of symbolism. These are my observations in this matter. Professor Panduranga Bhatta is going to deliver his scholastic lecture. As I know him, he is a man with sound knowledge of ancient Indian wisdom and ancient Indian history of the wisdom, Indian wisdom. And he is having a practical way of seeing our problems around. I wish a very good performance of my friend Professor Panduranga Bhatta today in this virtual platform. Greeting Professor Panduranga Bhatta and all other listeners, I beg to remain. Thank you.
Good evening to all. I'm very happy to be here. And before starting my lecture, I would like to thank so many people associated with Kantaluru Sala who have invited me for this evening lecture. E.V. Narayanan, who rendered a wonderful Vedic invocation, and welcome address delivered by Subramanyam Musad, and presidential address none other than my good friend Murali Madhavan. He has summed up leadership qualities. After my lecture, I think there will be two more persons. Madhavan Nambothiri will be appearing, and also Dr. G. Ramamurthy. Let me thank all these people who have taken trouble, and also they have given me a challenging topic. And Dr. Pradeep is there. He will help me when I want some kind of help from him. Yeah. So before we get this slide, I will start. Yeah. As I said, a challenging topic has been given to me. Inclusive leadership. Of course, I can talk about this from any angle, but now they have restricted insights from Sanskrit literature. As Dr. Murali Madhavan has shared some of the wonderful insights from Mahabharata, Bhagavad Gita, whatnot. So now, go to the next. I will try to share some of the ideas which we discussed. Before that, yes, a small academy has started, Samanvaya Academy for Excellence. If you look into our motto, Sarvaha Sarvatra Nandatu, it is taken from Kalidasa's drama. May everyone everywhere be happy. As Murali Madhavan pointed out a little bit, confusion, calmness has gone, everyone is worried, stressed, we don't know, corona, so many other things are happening. So is it possible to have some kind of happiness? So is it possible for leaders to create that type of happiness? These are the issues we have taken in our academy and so many programs we conduct. Okay, next. What happened after 10 years of my service in IIM Calcutta, we thought of writing a book using a lot of insights from India, Indian ethos, and a lot of insight from Western ethos. Because now learning is, it's from multidisciplinary platforms. And before going to next slide, I would like to thank Murali. Other day I was attending his, let it be here. Murali was telling something about no discrimination in admission in Kantaluru Sabha. That is very interesting. That is going to be discussed in this, in my presentation also. No discrimination of based on religion, caste, creed. We are all one human. See, we chant Vasudhaiva Kutumbakam and Sarve Jana Sukhina. What is Sarva in Sanskrit? There is no even gender discrimination. It's not there. Caste discrimination, language discrimination, not there. I think I really congratulate our Sabha, particularly the Kannur Sabha, which they have started. And second, very interesting thing, he was harping on inclusive or interdisciplinary studies. I may even upgrade that into multidisciplinary studies. That's a fantastic norm. So we used all these techniques in this book, The Art of Leading in a Borderless World. And it has got a lot of appreciation from all over the world. So if you look by and look into nearly some 2-3 pages, renowned scholars from East and West, they have appreciated our contribution to this field. So what is borderless leader? And today, of course, I'm going to touch a little bit inclusive leader. Next. Now, these are the important points when you say inclusive leader. Now, what is happening? World is interconnected, borderless, multi-dimensional in nature. So now leadership has to consider this. So heterogeneity and plurality are the problems and how they are going to solve. What are the solutions from our literature? Maybe I'm going to give some kind of solution from Sanskrit literature. So Sanskrit literature means we start with Vedic literature. Our Rig Veda, for example, one of the earliest written documents of humankind. Now, then followed by when we use philosophical works, particularly you are having this in Kerala. I'm a worshipper of Adi Shankaracharya, for example. I think we have not understood his contribution. So sometimes I don't hesitate to tell, either when I refer to Shankaracharya or Vivekananda or Gandhi, we all keep their photos and we worship them on their birthdays, but we don't venture into what they have said, particularly younger generation. I want to reach the younger generation through this particular lecture. I think we should read. See, first you read. It is not that difficult in our internet. Internet platform is there, WW is there, and anything at your hand. But try to read Adi Shankara, for example, what contribution he has made. I will come to one or two particular point, what he has made with regard to inclusion. Then Murli has said Mahabharata, so I don't touch Ramayana, Mahabharata, Kautilya. I may touch Kalidasa. He is the Sanskrit poet, voice of Sanskrit literature. So if you study Kalidasa, you have studied everything. I think that type of credit he deserves, because you know he has a very liberal mind, unlike other poets or other persons, very liberal. So he was not hesitating to throw it away. In one of the dramas, he says, for example, Purana mitteva nasadu sarvam santaha pariksha anyatarat bhajante. Now that type of freedom we should give to people. I think because world, it is gone. No more. Now in the present day 21st century, that is not the valid statement to be given. So he says, santaha pariksha anyatarat bhajante. A good person, a great person, a wise person looks into it. So Indian history, Indian literature, Indian philosophies, that type of thing. They have not accepted anything because it is stated by so and so. Nothing of that sort. So they have used their own discretion, their own intelligence, then they have come to some conclusion. So we have the Arthashastra of Kautilya, then Banabhatta, very good prose writer in Sanskrit. Particularly, there is a advice given by Shukanasa, one minister, to Chandrapida, who was the prince and was about to become a king. I think we look into one or two examples from that. I don't have too much of time. I think I may have to finish by 4:30 or so. Let me see. Then Raja Dharma. This, I think Murli Madhavan referred to this. This is a whole lot of things are there. How leaders should govern, what should be his priority, and all those things are very clearly discussed. Kalidasa means pravartatam prakriti hitaya partiva. He says, let the king strive for the welfare of the subject. So he sees in Sanskrit, the loka sangraha, that is the welfare, then the sarva, the all. So now if any leader focuses on these two aspects, I think he will be very successful. So now in this lecture, because our time may be 15 minutes or 1 hour, so I would like to concentrate on three inclusions. One is inclusion of environment. That is the dangerous thing that is happening right now. I think so many states, so many calamities due to heavy rain, due to this and that. So or even corona, for example, some people are attributing to bad environment. So how to, what is our knowledge about environment or understanding whether it is for us to experience, enjoy, or we have to contribute something towards environment. This will be taken up first. Then we move to religion. Second, most important troubling matter now. So what is your religion? What is their religion? And what to do, how to allow them to live, or how I go and live in another country with my religion? All these problems will be addressed. And the last is the human beings. So sometimes tragedies are happening because we don't like certain people. Maybe their color, maybe their gender, so maybe their race. Now, is there any solution? Sanskrit literature gives us these other things. Next, please. Now, let me start with Vedic statement. Anu Bhadraha Kratavo Yantu Vishvat. This is a wonderful statement which occurs in the Rig Veda. Many auspicious thoughts come to us from all over the world. They are very specific, they are very clear. We are not supposed to get some kind of bad thoughts from other countries or other parts of our own country. So auspicious, Mangala is a very interesting word in Sanskrit. So auspicious thoughts always should come, and there should not be any border restriction. No, I don't want to learn it from them. I don't want to learn it from this particular part, this particular, nothing of that sort. So let us be open, liberal, anu bhadraha kratavo yantu vishvat. So this is the true character of India. If you read Indian history, sometimes, you know, people, they don't know, they don't read Indian history, then come to some kind of conclusion. I don't like that. I think I may suggest a very good book, authentic book, The Wonder That Was India by A.L. Basham. I think he has done wonderful justice to all topics. He has not written it in with a parochial mindset or something like that. So if you read such books, The Wonder That Was India, now Shakas and the Kushans, for example, they came to India. Now what happened? We absorbed them. We allowed them to explore. We allowed them to explain their arts, architecture, philosophical systems, everything we respected. Now, when I was reading Brihat Samhita of Varahamihira, I got a wonderful quotation. See, Yavanas, for example, Greeks or some foreigners, sometimes we call them Mlechas. Now, the word foreigner or the word Mlecha is a little bit not that good. So we are not giving, we are not using with great respect. We want to, reject them, that type of thing. And what Varahamihira, our own sage, said is very interesting. Mlecha hi Yavanastu, Yavana and Mlecha, for example. Samyak Shastramidam Stitam. Our, for example, astronomy, he was referring to that, well established in them. So what we should do now? Rishivat tepi pujyaha syuhu. They should be worshipped like our own rishis. See, what is the mindset of our people? We don't understand, we don't read at all. So rishivat tepi pujyaha syuhu kim punaha daivabit dvijaha. So like Brahmins, they should be treated like dvija, for example, like a scholar in India, they should be treated. So this is the respect given to knowledge that is coming from outside India. Next. Now, I take a specific example. So when I was reading, for example, Abhinav Gupta, so while Dvanya Loka commentary or some other books, he has a concept called Shastra Sammelana. What is this now in West, for example, they are talking 21st century, what type of mind you should develop. So they start with inclusive mind, ethical mind, respectful mind. I think Dr. Abdul Kalam is the best example. So he was telling, so you should have a respectful, what is the meaning of respectful? So if you have 5,000 years history in India, once when I was meeting him over the cup of tea when he visited our institute, he was sharing this insight with me. So you have 5,000 years history, you should read and you should have respect for their ideas, Vivekananda, Gandhi, so many. So now Abhinav Gupta says, wonderful actually, he says something like Viveka Sopana Paramparanam. Our ancestors have created some kind of pedals, some kind of ladder is there, step-by-step ladder you can reach. So, urdvordvam ahurya, yadartha tattvam, dihi pashyati, shrantam avedayanti. We don't feel any strength because they have already worked, they have spent their lifetime. So, it is very easy. Phalam tadadyaihi parikalpitanam. So, what they have given to us, we have to respect it. Viveka Sopana, so it is one step, okay, it helps us to climb the ladder, that is it. Tasmat satamatra na dushitani, therefore I don't criticize, I don't blame. There is a little bit difference between criticism and blaming. Criticize, you have your theory, you don't like other theory, okay. But you are not supposed to blame, because you don't know whether he is what he is telling is truth or not. So what he says is fantastic. Tasmat satamatra na dushitani matani tanyeva tu shoditani. What's that? I have researched for the shoda, that's all. Shoda I have done. So Vedic literature is there, Upanishad is there, Mahabharata is there. This time you go on adding. That's all. You don't criticize. They are not adding when you value are there. They have not done it properly. They have not, seen it in a proper angle. And all those things you are not supposed to give. So the very interesting thing, what we learned from Abhinav Gupta is that we should have a respectful mind towards our earlier. Maybe in any field, I'm not telling only the, the Shastra Sammelana, even science also, what earlier scientists have done, we have to respect. Or even in politics, I say, I don't hesitate to tell that, what earlier have done, we have to accept and go further. See, Rigveda Mantra says, Charaiveta, Charaiveti, Charaiveti, the Muan, Muan, Muan. Don't stop and blame others. That will not take you anywhere. I think this is a wonderful thing what we learn. Next. Yes. Now, I have great respect to Adi Shankaracharya. You are, particularly this program is sponsored or held under the auspicious organization of the Kantaluru Sabha. And Murli Madhavan, my senior, has already mentioned that. So, he criticized Buddhism. That's okay, because he has his own intellectual wisdom and he met with some faults or something. But he worships Buddha, so to say. What he says is, see, I worship that spiritual radiance which manifested as Buddha, who was all-knowing. See, words used by him, conqueror of Maya, who was full of mercy and who was adored by those who were opposed to the performance. Animal sacrifice was there at the time of Buddha, particularly in Veda. So Buddha strongly criticized. He, Shankaracharya, says at another place, Buddha did not criticize Veda, did not blame Veda. He blamed only certain things, certain practices, blind practices, which are not ecologically acceptable, even from the point of view of Vedas. So that's all. Otherwise, Buddha is worshipped by Shankaracharya. So we learn lessons. So what words he has used, spiritual radiance, is very all-knowing, that type of thing. Next. Now I come to the topic, because I wanted to give you some foundation. What type of, so with these foundations, Shankara's insight about Buddhism, Buddha, and Abhinav Gupta, what he said, what we should do with regard to the earlier or stored knowledge. So we are going to look into three types of inclusions. I call pillar of inclusion, environment. I have written a lot of articles about this. I just give some idea for that. So now every day, this is the main topic in media, in newspapers, international topic, international seminars, international meetings. conferences, seminars among the world leaders, everything about the environment. Do we have something? So Sanskrit literature, for example, inspires us to look into environment with reverence. Now, I'm not going to tell you something new. You all know that. You have so many prayers. In prayers, what we do, we worship earth, bhumi, prithivi apteja vayu akasham. So bhumi we worship, jala we worship, then fire, agni we worship, then vayu we worship, antariksha we worship, a lot of hymns. Then we worship animals also, plants and trees, because forest animals, they go into some kind of interaction with us. There is interrelationship with us. We can't treat nature as separate and human beings as separate. Nature is completely whole, flora, fauna together. So we can't pick up, okay, this particular, I'll come to that. So some kind of kinship we have to establish. We have established it. We have to revive that. The birds, bees, plants, everything. Various species of animals and birds enter into, as I said, our lives. Out of compassion. So now we must promote the welfare of the world by setting right examples, right norms. If that is not there, we may not be able to have a good life, or we may not be able to have a good environment. Next. Now, this is very interesting. Madhuvata rutayate madhum kshiranti sindavaha madvirna santoshadihi madunattam utshav madumat parthivam rajah madudyaurastu napita. What a beautiful prayer. So you read the, I have highlighted some words for you, though some of you may not understand, because many are attending this program from other parts of the world also. I have sent, shared the invitation. So for the, see, eternal law is there. Environment has its own law. Respect that. What are the constituents of environment? Winds, rivers, many plants, night and dawn, Father Heaven, forest trees, sun, cows, that's all. So what's a sweet, sweet, sweet? Several times they use the word madhu. So let me not do any harm to these things. Let me not do any harms to things mentioned here. So let me do only sweet things. Let me take care of them. That will give a lot of benefit to me. Next. Now, Vedic literature, as you, many of you know, Vedic literature seeks fellowship with every living being. And the same is expressed in the following hymn of the Yajurveda. Now, Yajurveda states that services to animals is heavenly activity. Now they are coming to some kind of, first is prayer, that is fine, and people are not accepting that, people are not following that, then the punishment part starts. So no person should kill animals, helpful to all. Second, now if you serve the animals, if you take care of the animals, you will gain heaven, that is happiness first, of course, then in another hymn, heaven also. Now I come to very important insight from Mahabharata. Now we have not understood the interdependence of forest and the tigers. When tiger was simply disappearing, we thought, let it go. Anyhow, it is causing some harm to us. Why should we protect? Mahabharata, which was composed, what, roughly 2000 years back, they have a statement, the forest and tiger are interdependent. Now, if you remove forest, tiger will not be there. That's all. If you remove tiger, forest will not be there. What a beautiful thing. Coexistence of wild beasts. Now, this brings me to a very new concept called deep ecology. Now, America has started this. Many universities, American universities, are giving. In fact, we are the champions of deep ecology. What is deep ecology? Let me take this statement, what I say, the tiger, for example. So some statement I give, some tiger should not be killed. Now you analyze that from two perspectives. First is ecological perspective. Second is deep ecological perspective. Then you will understand. So first let us try ecological perspective, environmental. Why tiger should not be killed? If tiger goes out of the planet, so many new diseases may come. A lot of research. they have gone. So this, we can't allow tiger to become extinct. So tiger should be protected. That is the ecological environmental approach. Come to deep ecology. This is a very new science. Maybe 5-6 years old. That's all. What is deep ecology? So why tiger should not be killed? Ask the question to deep ecology person. He will say, why tiger should not be killed? Because it is there. It has been created by God. We don't know what is the purpose, and we don't know if tiger also goes out of the planet, whether any deadly, more deadly than corona will visit us. We don't know. We have not done research. Our research is nascent, very, very meager. So therefore, I think now when you come to Vedic, particularly scriptures and Upanishad scriptures, you have the deep ecological approach. They don't calculate anything. I come to that next. Now, before going to that, see, we have been made to take care of the nature in a different manner. We owe some debt. You may simply ask the question, sir, why I owe some debt? I have not taken anything from the nature or anything from any person. No, no. Nature has given you so many things when you are born. Free air, free wind, so many things. So how will you discharge? How will you come out of that debt? So they have very simple thing. I think Indians are not troubling you. No rites, rituals, something like that. Don't worry about that. If you have a runa, if you have some debt towards the nature, you can discharge that in simple means. So if you have some debt, here deva is only 5 primary elements. Prithivi, Aptejo, Ayu, Akasha, that's all. So yajnas are there, small yajnas they used to perform. And if you are not interested in yajna, get into the prarthanas. That's why I say, if you read Vedic literature, full of prarthanas, Prithivi Sukta, Bhumi Sukta, Agni Sukta, Surya Sukta, all. So that makes us feel that they understood the importance. And when you come to Ayurveda, they are dependent all, they know the pollution of the air, pollution of the light, pollution of the water. So they, that's why they say prarthanam is the respect. Again, it also creates respect, and you will offer prayers to various. In the early Vedic period, there were no Ganeshas or Krishnas or Ramas and all those things. What is the Veda? Rigveda, for example, if you go to Rigveda, lot of hymns are in praise of Agni, in praise of Surya, in praise of Varuna, in charge of water, all those things are there. Now I don't go into other runas. There are so many runas, Pitru runa and Manushya runa. I come to Bhutara because my lecture is dedicated to environment in the first part. So Bhutara runa means we, so many birds, so many insects help us. We don't know, we have not understood how they help and all those. Only some research people come and yes, this particular thing is added to environment because of this insect, because of the snake, because of the tiger, something like that. So our ancient Indians understood this, sages, they say, Bhutaruna, you have a debt towards subhuman species. I think Bhutaruna. So how to do that is Bhuta Yajna. Again, care and share, that's all. You protect a cow, you protect horse, you feed the birds in the morning. So many, that's all. So I think ancient India is very simple. It is not complicated. Only thing is we have not understood ancient India. If you want to understand, all these things are very simple. So do it now. I come to Rangoli, for example, in South India, it is very popular decoration in front of the houses. Why it is done? Those who are drawing, they may not be knowing. Okay, beautiful designs, and now you can upload in Facebook and you can get the credit. But there is a philosophy. Philosophy is that you should use pure rice powder for the rangoli. Why? Because birds and other insects come, particularly ants and others, they come and pick up that. See the strategy behind this. That's why you are not supposed to use some kind of chemical powder. Get better effect. So that you will get so many likes in Facebook. No, don't use all those things. Chemical powders are not so. If you use such chemicals in your rangoli, you may, birds or insects may die. Don't do that. So this is a very interesting thing. So many things are there. Okay, next. Yes. Now, Bhagavad Gita, of course, I have written a very extensive paper. Now I just sum up. Now, Vishwarupa Darshana, we are not understood. So as I said, some said, we chant that and we like the sound and we all this, but have we tried to understand the philosophy that exists in Udupi, for example? Vishwarupa Darshana, you can go and they have created a big hall and all those things are there. But the thing is, message should go to people. What is this? The Supreme Being is manifesting itself as the human beings, animals, birds, vegetable kingdom, and that is the thing. When you are doing some injury to animals, you are doing injury, you are creating injury to God. That is that's why everything becomes sacred. So when you read Vishwarupa Darshana, that's a very beautiful scene, and sometimes these things should be created by Sanskrit universities. Particularly, even Kantaluru Sabha also can try. I think message should be conveyed. So what they have included, mountain, Himalaya, for example, Ashwatha. Why I have selected, of course, there are so many things and some of you would have read and all those things. Well, I have selected only one or two to point out the message. Ashwatha doesn't give any fruit and all those things. So it is not edible. Nobody eats that. But still it is sacred. Krishna wanted to create in our mind that everything belongs to him, everything is sacred. Look into that, cows, horses, any of all these things we know. Serpent, venomous creature, actually we are afraid of that, but God says, it is a part of me, don't worry about that. It's also divine, you should treat like that. Lion and all those things. Finally, Bhagavad Gita says that there is no being, whether moving or unmoving, which is not the part of Supreme. So the moment, we are going to touch Shankara's philosophy also later. So that is the very important thing. So the whole of Vishwarupa Darshana is there to create some kind of sense of sacredness among. I think when you are using this for different purposes, remember they are sacred and they belong to God. So Vishnu Purana, for example, says that the humans, animals, bird, trees, and crawling creatures forms the Lord of Vishnu. Because if you have not understood the philosophy existing behind Vishwarupa Darshana, then you come to Vishnu. They're very clear. So that's why it says that equal consideration of all is a real world. Don't do anything. Sometimes, we are coming to that later. You need not worship too many things, too many gods, too many rites, rituals. Simply take care of your nature, that's all. If you sometimes you are causing some kind of destruction to the nature or the animals, then you are worshipping, going to temple, going to Tirupati, going to this. I think purpose will not be served. That is that this message should be taken very clearly, and it is not coming from me, it is coming from Puranas and Bhagavad Gita. Next. Now I come to Kalidasa. As I said, inculcating environmental value. So now why you should read poetry? Of course, big charcha is there. My senior and junior are attending this. Senior is Murli Madhavan and junior is Dr. Radhakrishnan. He is also there. So they are judging me. So in poetry, so we have Kavyalapam Varjayet something. You should not read poetry. And Mammata and others later, they have come and clarified, no, it is not like that. There are so many benefits. Kavyam, Yashase, Arthakrite, Vyavahara Vide, something. Vyavahara Vide, that is very important. I take that point. So poetry teaches you how to behave. I never thought that poetry is just read and enjoy and forget. No, not like that. There are many. And if you read Sanskrit poetry, there they teach you, for example, how to interact with the higher person, how to interact with another person, equal person, so all these things are there. There's the vyavahara. Now, what is the vyavahara with regard to environment? Kalidasa is a master poet. I think if you read, nowadays a lot of books, all these books are available in Google and free of cost also. Rashtriya Sanskrit Samsthan is there, and so many organizations are supporting. Read Kalidasa. Then another thing, I see the characters created by Kalidasa, they reveal certain secrets. How to treat nature? Kalidasa may not say that you see in sometimes, we say in Sanskrit, the teaching is like Prabhu Samhita, then the Mitra Samhita, then the Kanta Samhita. What is the Prabhu Samhita means Vedas, Satyam Vada, Dharmam Chara, speak the truth. Otherwise something will happen. So like a Raja, like a commander, like a king. That's okay. Mitra, the Upanishad, the Mahabharata, Ramayana, something like that, stories. The you should not do this. Friends, like a friends, they tell you. Then if you do that, something will happen, friend will tell. But friend will not have the power to stop you. You may say, I don't smoke. Okay, I smoke, what happened? Okay, it's your choice. That he can't prevent you. Come to Kavyas, Kalidasa, Bana, and this Kanta Samhita, like beloved, like spouses. So how they achieve their things, nobody knows in the world. So very beautiful message, the Kavya you read, and what type of message is inculcated through those characters and statements of the poets, you will never be able to tell directly, but you will experience that later. So Dushyanta, of course, for the Shakuntala only, I will give one or two examples. He says, you know, when he was coming to moving in the forest in the chariot, see, he tells, asks some very interesting question. Is that my sins have checked the flowering of the plant? Of course, he sees the garden, but he unpleasant and unpleasant things. So now there is a message for us. What is this? Leadership message. So leaders, of course, Murali has already quoted a little bit Raja Dharma in this one, Mahabharata. Now, Raja Kalasya Karanam. Leader is the maker of the time. Good time, bad time. That's all. Sometimes when good leaders are there, that type of, we all enjoy that period. When bad leaders come, they create hell actually. So that is there. So Dushyanta was very sensitive. I think he was asking that question, have I committed any mistake so that these flowers, plants are not putting forth flowers, etc. See the consciousness of the person. So when, so this is the lesson for the leaders. Now Dushyanta was about to kill a deer. Immediately sages come and stop him. What they say, ashramam rugoyam, nahantavyo nahantavya. This is the protected species, ashramam rugoyam. This belongs to sacred land. You don't have any right to kill it. See the what type of the strategies they had. So ashrama, of course, you have beautiful descriptions of beautiful ashramas in Ramayana, Mahabharata, and so many other places. I read that. They protect. So king has no right. Now environment related problems. So whether this particular forest can be cleared, whether this particular the highway can be created by clearing thousands of trees. These are the questions we are facing. I think we are not supposed to cause any damage to the environment. That is what we learn from Kalidasa and others. Next, please. Now, the description of Shakuntala, the heroine of that particular drama, this is fantastic. And when she was about to leave her first father's hermitage, poet becomes emotional. So I think this is considered as one of the best scene in the whole world dramatic literature. No other Shakespeare or Milton or any other person you tell, they don't come to this particular the status that Kalidasa has, that descriptive power. And you weep. I think, again, Kantaluru Sabha should encourage students to put up dramas, particularly this scene, fourth act. That's why somebody said, don't read too much of Shakuntala. Kavyeshu natakam ramyam tatra ramya Shakuntala tatra api chaturtho ankaha tatra shloka chatushta. That's all. If you read four shlokas, selected shlokas in fourth act, that's your message. And one shloka I have taken for you. This is related to environment. Patum na pratamam vyavasyati jalam yushmasu api te shuya. Nadatte priyamandana api bhavatam bhavatam snehenaya pallavam. Adyevaha pratama prasuti samaye yasya bhavat yutsava. Seyam vyati shakuntala patigriham sarvai ramnyapyadam. I think one of the best shlokas in Sanskrit. I think he described Shakuntala. She was interested in decking herself with flowers and so, but she was not plucking. Now we have to put some birds in the garden, don't pluck, otherwise people will pluck and spoil the garden. See that Shiva, it is the inside discipline, that's what. Shakuntala, nobody told her, don't pick up rose or don't pick up another flower and take your, nothing of the sort. But she was having that consciousness. If I pick, then there will be some damage to the plant. See that affection which she had, so many shlokas are there, which reveal great affection which Shakuntala had towards all these plants, flowers and all those things. The deer cub was not allowing her to go when she was about to leave the ashram. That deer cub was pulling her sari. And she was asking, who is stopping me? Who is stopping me? Then Kanwa, her foster father, comes out to the beautiful. I think he tells when she was born, she lost her mother. And you brought her up. See, human beings at that time, bringing these animals, small cubs, taking care of their needs. Fantastic, actually. And therefore, this particular shloka is appreciated. And finally, I want to bring one message. May you all bid her farewell and goodbyes. Sarvaihi, who has to give the permission? Forest has to give the permission. We thought forest is there to enjoy, experience. We create so many modern facilities. No, it is not there. It has got its own consciousness. That's why in our book, this is the chapter, I think fifth chapter about environment. In heading we have given, if we care for nature, she cares for us. That's all. This is the message and it should be inculcated. We don't have any option now. We have to take care of this. Yes, next please. Yes, Bana, just I give one wonderful, there are beautiful descriptions of Vindhyatavi and so many other things. He is a master of Sanskrit poetry, Sanskrit prose, and using alankaras, figures of speech. I think you enjoy, sometimes you take Bana's Kadambari, whether you have finished 10 pages or 20 pages, you will not be able to say that. So I just give one small incident that happened. Harita, the sage boy, so he was going to take his ablution in the river. While coming, he sees a small the parrot cub. Then he goes near the parrot cub and it was about to die. And he picks up and takes to the lake and makes this parrot a little bit drink water, then brings. And he came to the conclusion that parrot cannot fly, too young. It's immature, something like that, not matured enough. So he, and now I have highlighted the line. He says to other sage boys, now you see, it should be nourished, the parrot cub, small parrot, baby parrot, so to say, should be nourished with juices of fruits and collections of grains brought to him by ascetics and by myself. You have to understand, leader. That's all. You can't say, no, okay, take care of that, everyone. Now, so many things are happening around us. No, they will take care of that. I have appointed so many people. Nothing of that. Personal involvement. Have you gone to that place? That's the thing. Have you shown some kind of personal concern? So this is the thing. So he says, by myself, I will bring some pomegranate seeds or something every morning and feed. In another statement is very interesting. With the wings grown, and able to fly into sky, he may go where he likes, and we don't want, because it's so beautiful, we will put in a cabbage and we will keep in. That's not possible. Box, you can put. Cage, you can put, no. Continue to stay here. So if he wants to continue here, stay here, there is no problem. Why he says, if he becomes so much attached to us. So we are giving him this baby parrot every day, pomegranate juice and other things. So he thinks, sometimes he may think, let me stay here for some more days. Good hospitality. Allow him. So two things. If he wants to go, we can't hold him. See the freedom given to these birds and other things he wants. And if he is not interested, if he wants to stay here some more, Atithi Devo Bhava. It is extended to animal kingdom also. Next. Yes, now we are coming to the second pillar. I have summed up the first pillar. What is our responsibility? What is leader's responsibility towards flora, fauna? So many things are there. Now the controversial, the religion, for example, every day we hear so many people killed, so many people bombed because of religious difference. So Rigveda, this is the starting again. Rigveda should be the fountainhead, at the fountainhead of all this. Ekam sat vipra bahudha vadanti. One and the many theory, that's all. Truth is one. People who have realized the truth, they have described differently, that's all. I have a close friendship with Mahatma Gandhi's grandson, Arun Gandhi. He is in America sometimes. He was contributing articles to our magazine. So his lecture later, if you are interested, you can email me. I think all available in what's called in YouTube. I think one lecture is Love Thy Neighbor. Love Thy Neighbor. This is a fantastic lecture delivered by none other than grandson of Mahatma Gandhi. That is very important. Why I say people have different type of perceptions. So you may say he is Buddha, another may say he is Shiva and Vishnu, but reality, Supreme Being is only one. Only approaches, he was telling, I think Arun Gandhi was telling in one of his lectures, see, it is just going, climbing the mountain through different routes. You have got one route and somebody else has. And when you go to the mountain, you all see only one temple, one god or something like that. That is the thing. So ascending. So then very beautiful in some of the schools, they have accepted this as the prayer. Sangachadvam samvadadvam samvadadvam samvomanam si janatam. What is this? Meet together, talk together. May your mind apprehend the truth alike. So what is this accommodative spirit in religion, particularly religious domain? You have to be very careful. Take and give, that's very important. And let live, that live and let live, that's all. Otherwise, there is no solution for all this. I think if you are expecting any solution for religious conflict, this is the only solution. And our Upanishads, every day we recite the Sahana Bhavatu Sahana Bhunaktu Sahaviryam Karavavai Tejasvina Vadita Mastu Mab. Last line I heard, Ma Vidvishavahai, no intolerance related to religion, no hate speech. I'm coming to that. And some of the ministers now, when our Honorable Prime Minister Modi ji reshuffled his cabinet, and some of the ministers were asked to delete all their tweets, communal, anti-communal tweets. I think that is the right thing. What they have. In this particular, Murli Madhavan started the presidential address. Calm, peace, all our Vedic mantra. Om Shanti, Shanti, Shanti. How do you create Shanti? So these are the means and methods. Next. Yes, this is fantastic. I think this is taken from one of the Sanskrit texts. Tarko apratishtaha shrutayo vibhinna. Naiko rushiryasya matam pramanam dharmasya tattvam nihitam guhayam mahajano yena gatah sapantha. Do you have a shruti? Maybe you are the Vedic literature or sacred scriptures which are not contradictory. No, they are contradictory. Some passages are contradicting. Then the tarka, you can use logic and win. No. Some other person use better intelligence and he will win over you. I have seen many debates taking over about these issues. Nothing. Then, na eko rushihi yasya matam pramanam. There is not a single rushi whose opinion we all follow. We divide. No. He is not right. That the dharma. So what is truth? It is hidden in the caves. What is the way out for us? Mahajano yena gata sapanta. That's all. Take them, what is Mahajana? Then a spiritual person comes to my mind. Not ordinary persons who are preaching religion and all those things. Spiritual persons are difficult to find. They practice what they preach. So that is very important. Some of the sages, great sages, Vasishta in Ramayana and other spiritual persons. So that is there. So next. Yes. Now, not only this continues, one and the many, many examples are there. Trayi Sankhyam Yogaha, Pashupati Matam Vaishnavamiti, Prabhinne Prastane Paramidam Adaha, Patyamiti Cha, Ruchinam Vaichitriya, Druk Ruju Kutila, Nana Patajusham, Drunam Eko Gamyas Pamasi, Payasam Arnava Yuga. What a beautiful civilization. All rivers go to ocean only. So like that, you know, in the Vedas, three Vedas are there. At one point of time, they did not include Atharva Veda. Sankhya is there, Yoga is there, and Shaivism is there, Vaishnavism is there. All are different routes to approach this single reality. Ruchinam, it is up to your taste. Somebody likes this type of worship, somebody likes another type of, you do that. That's all. So finally, this is, so when this is the case, why do you quarrel? Next. So again, Kalidasa comes to my mind. I think I should thank Dr. Radhakrishnan, my junior. So he was requesting me to write one paper for his the university journal when he was the professor in Pondicherry Central University. I think I wrote one article about this, the inclusive approach in our religion. It's very, Kalidasa comes to our mind. See, Brahma temples are there, Shiva temples are there, then Vishnu temples are there. Once upon a time, they used to quarrel even. No, Vishnu is great, Shiva is great, Brahma is great. They used to destroy their the sacred places. And Kalidasa says, all these three are one only. Look into this shloka, what he says. Namo Vishwasrije Purvam Vishwam Tadanu Biprate Atha Vishwasya Samhartre Tubhyam Tredastitam Atmane. Tredastit, you are three, divided into three. So that is related to your work. When you create, you are called Brahma. When you sustain, when you maintain the world, you are called Vishnu. When you destroy, you are called Shiva. Once upon a time, in India, the Vaishnavites were not going to Shiva temple, Shaivites were not going to Vaishnava temple. Like that, if somebody goes, Vaishnava goes to Shiva temple, he considers he has polluted himself, he has to come back and take bath. All those things have gone from our land now. Thanks to these great Acharya, Shankara and Kalidasa, for example. Next. Yes, now I come to Adi Shankara from there. So Murali said, and also I think we all should thank that India has produced such a wonderful great sage. So again, I don't hesitate to tell, we celebrate his birthday, we go to his temple, Sringeri Sharada temple is there. But have we applied our mind? Have we read at least Bhaja Govindam? Complete, not only read, okay, you sing very beautifully, but have you tried to understand what Shankara tells there? This is once upon a time, Shiva, Vishnu, Shakti, Surya, Ganesha, Kartikeya, different type of rites, rituals, different type of quarrel. And Shankara brought them under one umbrella. Shanmata Stapaka, he is, okay. So he integrated. He could integrate because of his philosophy of Brahma. That's why if you understand the Supreme Being, then you don't say, so why only Ganesha should be worshipped? Why Durga should not be worshipped? I'm openly asked some type, no, you worship only him. No, that is not possible. In India, it's impossible. So I am a worshipper of Ganesha. I like Ganesha. I celebrate Ganesha. That's all. I may not worship other gods or goddesses. Don't blame. That's all. So Shankara's support is there. Next. Yes, I give one. See, as Murali said, I should give some kind of practical examples. See, Vijay, I have written that book, Contribution of Karnataka to Sanskrit. It is running to some 700 pages. A lot of research. Now, I came across this inscription, which is in Kannada, but later it is translated to English. So, Bukkaraya, again, 14th century. Now, Bukkaraya, Hakka Bukka, they are the founders of Vijayanagara. They had this spiritual guru, Vidyaranya. That is very important. Vidyaranya guided them. And one of the most harmonious kingdoms in India, Vijayanagara Samrajya. That's very interesting. So what happened? See, Jainas were there in Karnataka. They came with the Jainamuni long back, Bahubali and all those things. They have their own temples, basidis, and they were very peace-loving people. The Veerashaivism, for example, the Vaishnava, Sri Vaishnavas particularly, they came. And they started their own, and king also a little bit embraced their religion. This is the problem. Once king embraces message meant something like that, you can do harm to all others. So now only this religion, no other religion, you can do harm. And you see the spiritual leader at that time, that is very important, the Karaya, spiritual. He did not think over what should be done when people are quarreling, when people have started destroying Basjis, Sri Vaishnava devotees. Then immediately he called next day meeting all the holy people, sacred people, sages from both the communities, Jaina community and Sri Vaishnava. And as per the inscription, he asked them to hold their hand like this, Jaina hand and the Sri Vaishnava hand. And he gave this inscription. If loss or advancement should be caused to the Jaina Darshana through the Sri Vaishnava, the Sri Vaishnavas will kindly deem it as loss or advancement caused to their own religion. The Sri Vaishnavas will, to this effect, kindly set up Shasana inscription in all their worshiping places, kingdom. And next message, for as long as the sun and the moon endure, Sri Vaishnava creed will continue to protect Jaina Darshana. Sri Vaishnavas and Jainas are the one body. They must not be viewed as different. After that, there was no communal clash. I have read the complete Karnataka. Even now, Karnataka, of course, maintains harmony among all religions. Jainas are there, Christians are there. Even our national anthem says that we have a Jaya Bharata Jananiya Tanujate. Wonderful master poet Kuvempu created that, and that should say, I am helping our Honorable Prime Minister's projects also. Ek Bharat Shrestha Bharat, I am involved, and sometimes I give this suggestion. Karnataka has created this a beautiful song. So there is no clash of human beings, clash of religions, clash of this, if they are faithful to this state song. So why can't you create such songs to other states also? We should think, we should work on those things. Next. Yes, now I come to the relevance of this. Once you establish that type of mindset, that type of thinking, then you need not worry. So now successor of Bukharaya, particularly his son Harihara too, he also encouraged the plural religious attitude, plural, many religions. And somebody composed this, Yam Shaiva Samupasate Shiva Iti Brahme Iti Vedantino Bauddha Buddha Iti Pramana Patavaha Karte Iti Nayayikaha Arhan Nityata Jaina Shasana Rataha Karme Iti Vimamsakaha Soyam No Vidadatu Vanchita Phalam Trailokyanatu Hari. This is the fantastic religious harmony. Inscriptions and translated what? Like, you see, you may worship Hari, you may worship Shiva, you may worship Brahma, and Buddhist, they included Buddhist also here. Mimamsakas are there, karma champions, Nayayika, Jaina they included. Even though Buddhist and Jains, for example, they oppose Veda, they apaurusheya, for example, they apaurusheya, and of course, they don't accept all those things. But still, they are included. Now, people are becoming enlightened, particularly 14th century, 15th century. Next, yeah. Now, I just ask, again, I refer to Murli Madhavan. We should give present examples, practical. I met this Swami many times, the Bharati Tirtha Swamiji, when he was in power. I was taking students to Sringeri, and we used to make a point that we should meet Swamiji in the afternoon, maybe 4 o'clock, 5, half an hour discussion that was doing. So now you see what happened is fantastic story. I think he was invited in what's called 1994 by Buddhist people but to visit Daneka Stoop, that where Buddha delivered his first sermon. And Shankaracharya was accorded a grand welcome by Buddhist. This is something what Shankaracharya told on that context. Every textbook should have this. Sringeri Shankaracharya said, the principles of non-violence, compassion, truth, self-restraint, and purity were meant for every individual. One might go to a temple, vihara, or church, but the faith and belief were the same. Noble thinking, and it should be there, and it should be. I just give a small example. One, I think I was teaching tourism in Pondicherry, so I was taking tourism students to students on a field trip. Something practical. So when we went to Sringeri, it was 12:30 or something, noon. Then student said, we are hungry, and also we came to know Mutt is providing some food. We want to take that. Then I was hesitant. I was not, because I am away from Karnataka for 40 years. I was not knowing what happened. Even though I studied in Sringeri, I was not knowing that. So I did one thing, see, because so many mutts and these religious sacred temples and mutts, they have their own rites and rituals. We are not supposed to break that. So I said, let me talk to manager. Gauri Shankar, still he is the manager. So I met manager and said, I have 30 students. Some of them are Christian, some of them are Muslim, some of them, I don't know what caste or what country, what caste. So they have expressed a desire that they want to take food in. What to do? You know, with folded hand, Chandramouli, he said, sir, our Swami, our Guru, at that time Bharati Tirtha was there. We met him in the afternoon. He was telling, our Swami believes humanity is one. Vasudhaiva Kutumbakam. Anybody can take, no problem. So we entered the dining hall at about 1 o'clock, and there was a small problem. One of our Christian students, he injured his leg, and he was not able to, because you know you have to sit on the floor. It was the food was served on the banana leaf. So I had the problem. So what to do? Whether he stands when all are sitting? Will it go against the mutt rule or something? So one person was coming who was serving the food. He asked me, why he is standing, sir? I said, there is some injury and he can't. No, we will bring a stool or chair and let him sit comfortably and sit. What hospitality? What is that? So we are supposed to develop these types of thoughts. Think like that. So I think Mahabodhi Society should be congratulated. Why? Because Adi Shankara, for example, he is considered as a person who is responsible for the elimination of Buddhism or reduction of Buddhism in India, something like that. They invited him and honored him. Next. Yes, Dharmasthala. Again, we visited Virendra Hegde ji three times. All the three times we discussed with him various issues. Even when my book came, This Art of Leading in a Borderless World, he sent a message. I think he, fantastic temple, you know, there the Mahesh, the Shiva is worshipped in the form of Manjunatha. But the who is worshipping and all those things are very interesting. Virendra Hegde himself is a Jaina. Management is Jaina. Temple is Shiva. And even now, priests are coming from Vaishnava community. That's a practice. When we discussed it, he said, I want to continue this practice. This is the thing which India wants, the assembly of pluralism or assembly of all religions. Beautiful. And they also, every year they have this Sarvadharma Sammelana. I will show some photographs at the end. I think they started his, his seniors, ancestors started in 1933 also, almost nearing some 100 years or something. Every year, Christian fathers are coming, Maulvis are coming, Buddhists are coming. You see, this is beautiful actually, something like that. So that we should, Sarvadharma Sammelan, as Abhinav Gupta said, Shastra Sammelan, something like that. Here, Sarvadharma Sammelan. Next. Yes, Swami, we all studied in Vivekananda College, myself, Dr. Murli Madhavan and Dr. Radhakrishnan. We have imbibed something from that college because we used to move very closely with the Swamiji's and we used to participate in all the, because Sanskrit, when you are ready studying Sanskrit, you are given a higher position in that college. So you will be involved in so many activities. So we learned a lot. So this is what I learned from Swami Vivekananda. He is completely highly inspired by Shankara's Advaita. So what is this? Christianity, for example, is the love thy neighbor. Somebody may go and tell why I should love thy neighbor, why I should not injure him. And Swami says, no. So the Atman or the Paramatma also in the opinion of Shankara, Paramatma resides in him, in you and in him also. By injuring him, you will be injuring yourself. Once you extend this philosophy, Shankara Sadvaita, to human beings and to animal world and the plant world, everything will be solved. I think calmly, without any agitation, people will become enlightened. That should be the approach. Instead of holding so many protest marches, this, educate people, enlighten them about these issues. Next. Yes, I have come to the last pillar, and after that 1 or 2 minutes I take and I close. Third is the pillar of human inclusion. This is another problem. We are very famously, everyone quotes this, Vasudhaiva Kutumbakam. What is Vasudhaiva Kutumbakam? Have you understood the full shloka? I am nija paro veti ganana labhuchetasam. Udara charitanam tu Vasudhaiva. Now Udara charita is the question. If you simply say Vasudhaiva Kutumbakam, I don't know. It's only maybe a slogan. Now what is it? He is my person. He is another person. That distinction you can't do if you are Udara Charita. If you are, so let me add something, let me upgrade this Udara Charita or interpret Udara Charita as a spiritual person, not a religious person. I tell this in all my meetings. There is a big difference between religious gurus and spiritual gurus. Religious gurus, that they have their own this. I don't say anything against them, but the thing. But spiritual, your heart, Kanchi Shankaracharya, what's called the Chandrasekhara Saraswati. I think a beautiful person, spiritual person. What happened once a Muslim, I think, who was heading Babri Masjid Committee or something. He visited Chandrasekhara Saraswati Swami. Chandrasekhara Saraswati Swami said, okay, you have, because they were good friends. So you have visited me, that's good, but there is a masjid next to this mat. Please visit that masjid. Kanchi Acharya, Chandrasekhara Saraswati, is telling the important leader of Muslim, please visit your own. That is, I consider all as same. What punya you are getting visiting Kamakshi temple or Kanchi Shankaracharya, but same punya you get visiting your own masjid. That is the thing. That is Udara Charitanam to Vasudhaiva Kutumbakam. So all these things, yes. Next. Yes. Veda test, because no, we have to talk of this, what is happening around us. A lot of hate speeches. And sometimes WhatsApp and Facebook, and I don't want to read it all. Every day somebody is denigrated, somebody is some kind of bad, foul language. Look into Veda. We have come back to it. Madhu manishye, madhu janishye, madhu akshami, madhu vadishyami, madhu matim, devebhyo vachamat. See, this is avantu shobhayai pitaro anumodan. Let me generate sweetness. Let me speak sweetly. I say I have started hate speeches versus sweet speeches. Sanskrit supports us to speak, you know, speak sweetly. So you will, that is a very interesting thing. Only, I will talk only sweet words. I will, as Abhinav Gupta said, I will not condemn. I will respect him also, even though I differ from him. Speak, this is a beautiful thing. God protect and all this. Next. So we have almost come to the end. I may finish in. Yeah, Shankaracharya, Adi Shankaracharya. This is the Manisha Panchakam, some of you. Why? Five wise verses or something. So if you, those of you who have not heard this story, I tell you, Shankara is a great number one philosopher of India, enlightened and realized soul. We don't have any words to describe Shankaracharya's knowledge with them. He was going, after taking bath, he was going on the bank of the Ganga in Kashi. A chandala comes, outcast person. So what happened? Shankara said, go away. Don't come. I am this and that. And Chandala replied, and that reply, Shankaracharya himself has composed. He has composed, he has put that reply very beautifully in five verses. Annamayad annamayam, annamayam, atava chaitanyameva chaitanya. Whom you are going to go away? The body made out of food, your body, my body, or Chaitanya, that supreme consciousness, supreme being, that is there, that is in you, that is in me. So Shankara was perturbed about the jnana of that, what to say, outcast. So he uses some kind of metaphors, you know, reflection of the sun in the waters of the Ganges, or in the water present in the streets of an outcast. Is there any difference? I think there are many Sanskrit shlokas. The Chandra, for example, there's a moonlight, separate moonlight for the sophisticated people and another moonlight for the downgraded people. Will it happen like that? Never. Learn some lessons from these Subhashitas also. So that is the thing, reflection of the sun, he said. So the golden water, for example, whether you hold it in golden vessel or earth, the muddy, this one, out of the pot, out of it, will there be any difference in the water? Nothing. Then Shankara realized. Then what he said finally, Chandalostu Satu Dijo Astu Gurure Gururiti Yesha Manisham. Now my firm conviction is this, you are my teacher. Shankara falls at the feet of this, the Chandala. This is the lesson. And this is recorded, the stories are there. And not only this, some people may doubt, okay, somebody has, because this interpolation is the biggest problem in Sanskrit. But I have read other Dashashloki, even Bhajagovindam. There also he talks like that only. Shankara is not to be confined to a particular caste or something. He is a preacher for the humanity, not for Indians, for humanity. Next. Yes. Yes, I come to the last. I want to show one or two what is happening, and I have contacted these people. This is the beautiful prayer hall in Narayana Hridayalaya, our health service in Bangalore headquarters. So Dr. Devi Shetty, I requested him while we were launching our program. He came and delivered a small talk also in that talk. He believes in that. This is a prayer hall. So a Muslim can enter, Christian can enter, anybody, Sikh can enter, Buddhist. One day when I entered, I think I found many people from Muslim community, Islamic worship and Christians prayer and good. What a beautiful thing. That 21st century borderless world is forcing us to look into these examples and repeat these examples elsewhere. Next. No, before that, yeah. This is the Dharmasthala. Every year they are having Sarva Dharma Sammelana. You can find Buddhist gurus, Hindu, Sikhs, and Islam, Muslim, everyone is there. Beautiful. We should ask such people to come and share. And I think Kantaluru Sabha can do, Sala can do a lot of these things. Next. Yes. I was in Dubai for almost 4 months. I came to know about their very interesting thing. Tolerance Bridge in Dubai, they created this a few years back, and November 16, that is the day celebrated, that is the day celebrated in this. They invite people from practicing different religions, right now UAE is having people living there drawn from 170 countries. And no quarrel, nothing. And now I'll show a very interesting thing. The present prime minister is an enlightened person. He goes with all religious people and, you know, he blesses everyone, that type of thing. And he has mentioned that hate speech is completely banned. You can't even, criticize Hinduism there, not only Islam or something, nothing. So he will not, he says all people should grow like that. Next. Yes, this is our Honorable Prime Minister will inaugurate maybe after another 6 months or so. See, this is the what's called the Pratishtapana, this Bhumi Puja, later the founding ceremony for stone founding or whatever it may be. No, the Abu Dhabi King is participating. He is doing something related to that. He is included. And I came to know later the way in which they are building a huge Hindu temple. There will be scope for Muslims also go and pray in one part of the temple. I think that is the thing. Yes, next. This is my role is also there. I think we have already conducted some kind of program, online program. House of One in Berlin. All of a sudden, I came to know in BBC News and I contacted, they are open to this type of inclusive ideas. The people practicing different religions, people belong different races. See, what is world? What is Vasudhaiva Kutumbakam? Vasudhaiva Kutumbakam should reflect that. That's all. People from different races, different, no discrimination, no distinction. Next. So I have come to the last slide. Yes, yes. I think I have exceeded a little bit my time also. I thank sincerely. And I will explain this. I quoted from Kalidas. सर्वस्तरतु दुर्गाणि सर्वो भद्राणि पश्यतु सर्वः कामान् अवाप्नोतु सर्वः सर्वत्र नन्दतु. वी हैव एक्सेप्टेड और अडॉप्टेड सर्वः सर्व नन्दतु इन अवर समन्वय अकादमी. मे ऑल गेट across the difficulties, may all come by happy event, may all realize their wishes, may all be joyous everywhere. So I wish you all a very fruitful and forward journey. You should conduct more research and you should spread this type of message. And I am sincerely, I don't know how to thank these particularly Kantaluru Saha Sabha Sala also sometimes they call, and all these people are there. And Pradeep, thank you very much. You have helped me in carrying through the slides. So there was no difficulty at all. And I thank Murli, of course, Dr. Murli Dharan, my own senior. And I learned a lot from him also. And he is very heavily, busily engaged in what's called Kantaluru. So whenever I get invitation, definitely there will be Murli Madhavan name. Without him, I think he is the official officiating secretary also. And I thank all, and many people have come from other parts of the world, as I know. I have shared this invitation and Murli allowed me to share. I thank all of you. Thank you.
Professor Bhatta has given a wonderful scholarly lecture. Starting from Rigveda, he has gone up to the Kalidasa literature. He referred Vishnu Purana and several other Puranas, and Vishnu Dharmottara Purana, Ramayana and Mahabharata partially he referred. And mainly Shakuntala, he has given very, very vital points, how directly and indirectly this helps to the consciousness to form the inclusiveness of the leadership. And then he actually it was very fantastic that he referred even Mammada Bhatta, a poetician who wrote a shastra on the poetry. Even he took some passages and references from Mammada Bhatta. And Bana Bhatta, he referred, that is the unique, what we call prose writing composition in Sanskrit, one of the beautiful, that the Kadambari, and he referred that. And he referred several classic works, including The Wonder, that is India, that is by Basham. And he referred several small lyrics also, even not the great epics and mahakavyas like that. Even small compositions like Panchakam, where only 5 shlokas are there, and like Manisha Panchakam and other things. So his coverage was great, and his in the first part, in his presentation, the crux of the presentation was Raja Kalasya Karanam. That is very important. That was the how a leader can change the complete scenario of the of his country, and how his approaches should his approaches can make the citizens a free life, a happy life, a happy atmosphere in the throughout the country. So all these things he covered very beautifully. It's a vast area. We can take only just like Sthali Pulaga Nyaya, we say in English, in Sanskrit, that for testing the rice, whether it is cooked or properly cooked or not, we take only one rice and test it. We never take lakhs of rice, that grains will be there in the pot, but we take only one and we take and test, and with that we can know the whole rice has been cooked. So like that is Thali Gulaga Nyaya. So in that way, he has taken some small examples from each and every, gradually from Vedic literature, gone up to the classical literature, and he made a survey. And I think whatever he taken from the Vedic literature, even classical literature, each point can be discussed for 1 hour or 1.5 hours. This is a general lecture covering all these areas. What should be, what will be, or what is the nature of the Sanskrit literature, Sanskrit literature deals with. And it is with a human life. Whether you speak of Shakuntala or whether you speak of Pandava or Kaurava or Rama or Sri Krishna or whatever it may be, the poet speaks about the human life. So the very life of in the planet Earth. So that approach has been reflected and properly projected by Professor Pandurangabhatta. I know his scholarship, I know his oration, and the way of presenting the methodology of presenting scientific matters. So I have no wonder that he has done properly. And I have a request that Professor Bhatta should respond to our invitations in future also, and find time to attend our programs and give lectures on various topics. There are several topics where Professor Bhatta can give very authentic presentations. So we want Professor Bhatta in future also. With these observations, I request the participants to give their comments, their questions, if any, any commissions or omissions in the subject. I request the participants to come forward. Thank you.
So there are many good remarks about this program, especially about the presentation. There is no such questions.
Nothing.
Could not there. Find any. I already opened.
Yeah.
If anybody
want to ask any question, they can raise the question.
They can raise their hands and then we will.
They can do. Yes.
We express my thanks and respect to Professor Panduranga Bhatta. I am having much pleasure in seeing such a lecture, that too in management science. I have heard many lectures in about management, but I have that lectures never touched my heart so deeply like this, because the management problem is solved by resolution of conflicts historically evolved. We will usually say about the evolution of need of certain code of conduct and rules which are necessary for the peace and harmony of society. So how to manage people to be in harmonious living, that will be the subject. So always the management gurus say about the importance of the evolution of code of conduct and the need of serving. But here, the experience was different. Here, the principle of management that to touch our heart through art, literature, and Veda, that too, not by in a tone of preaching, but the natural instincts of human being. So natural love and appreciation, love to nature and fellow beings, all expressed in our literature and culture. So he has shown that this natural feeling of love, how it exists in our culture, especially in Indian culture. So his approach was more than logic, his approach was touching our hearts through the field of emotion. His methodology is methodology of demonstrating this idea or the lecture, presenting the lecture also, he touched more our heart than our brains. It is a wonderful experience, sir. Thank you. With all respects, I once again thank you for the Kandalur Sangha. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
The person who spoke is Sri Vedic scholar and our chairman of our trust, Kandalur Sabha, Sri K.N. Pooti, K.N. Narayanan Pooti.
Thank you, sir.
Yeah, now let me invite Unnikrishnan, Mr. Unnikrishnan.
Yes.
Sir, namaskar. I am a retired banker with practically very little knowledge about our Itihasas, Puranas and all. But at the same time, I am deeply interested in all those things. And during course of my career, I have attended several programs in various prestigious institutions, including IIMs, about leadership. But what I got today about inclusive leadership from Professor Bhatta, it was something totally different, and it opened a different perspective for me to understand what is hidden in our Upanishad, our Vedas, and various literature done by even Shankaracharya. All those things were giving a new insight to me to know that you need not read the Western classical books about management to find out what exactly is management. And unfortunately, I feel these things are not being expressed properly, even in, with all regards to Professor Bhatta, even in the IIMs also, I don't know whether they are giving that much importance to these types of classical examples where you can combine the wisdom of leadership even with your environments, where the coexistence of the environment along with human beings only will take us forward, and that will be the only way for us to exist. Really, thank you, sir. Would love to hear you more wherever you are. Thank you very much.
Murli,
thank you.
Answer. I think what Unnikrishnan said is correct, but I joined the Indian Institute of Management Calcutta in 97. And there was a center called Management, even now it is functioning, Management Center for Human Values. So then after joining, maybe after 2 years, I told them I can bring some kind of insights from Indian ethos. They welcomed and open to Indian ethos. So we started using texts like Bhagavad Gita for stress management and all these things. I think that continued for a long time, and I fully agree with you. I think we should have more such centers, and the meeting of East and West, what Rabindranath Tagore suggested long back, that should be, we should work out. Only East, then again you will be a Kupamanduka, or I will be a Kupamanduka if I say only West. That is the problem. So how to bring East and West together? I request you to read our book, The Art of Leading in a Borderless World. There is, it meets this particular requirement, East and West, because my colleague, Professor Pragyan Rath, she contributed from Western wisdom. I contributed from East. This is the first book which meets this particular requirement. Yeah, thank you.
Thank you. In fact, Professor Devashri Chatterjee, he has given a lot of insights about Bhagavad Gita and leadership, 18 chapters of Bhagavad Gita. He has given a new dimension to it. But again, still a lot of things have to be done. Thank you, sir. Yeah, thank you.
I agree. Lot of things have to be done.
Dr. Meelagiri. Doctor, I think. Unmute, please. Unmute.
Yeah, thank you very much, sir. I'm Srinivas. Delighted to hear you, sir. Sir, the deep ecology and ecology. Really, these two things are to be, we have to move forward into these things. And the task you have selected is really great, sir. And that ecology must be, and the problems of ecology must be addressed. And really, it was very informative and very heart-touching presentation, sir. So we need your blessings further in our institution also to start such a ecological and to make the balance of ecology of the world. So thank you very much, sir. I'll be in touch with you, sir. Thank you very much, sir.
Thank you.
Namaste.
Namaste.
In between, I want to refer one thing. When I gone through the lecture of Professor Bhatte, Bhatte has, whether knowingly or unknowingly, I don't know. I think he would have read that book by Professor Martha Venucci, who is an advisor to UNESCO. She belongs to Spain, and she hails from Spain. And she is a very good ecologist and a professor of ecology. She wrote Vedic ecology first.
Yeah, I have read that.
Yeah. Then next edition, when it came, the continuation of the Vedic, the concepts of ecology, she has slightly modified the title of the book. She told it is human ecology.
Okay.
So it is wonderful that how she realized that Vedic ecology is really human ecology. Then she gave me, I have invited her to my university when I was in Kaladi for a long time. And she gave a series of lectures on ecology. And she has given several, at that time she was studying Veda. It is some 20 years back. Now she is very conversant in the Vedic literature, and she is penned several authentic articles on Vedic literature. And that human ecology mentions about the deep ecology and its dimensions.
Very good. Thank you.
Thank you.
Mr. Nathan?
Yes, sir. Sorry, I just joined in. I'm from Malaysia. I represent the BRICS ASEAN Chambers of Commerce. I got the timing wrong. I thought it was Indian time at 5:30 when I checked this morning at Zoom. So I missed the whole lecture, and it's my saddest part. However, I was able to grab a bit of what been discussed, and I wish to join you all in future.
Thank you.
I'm really sorry.
This lecture will be available in YouTube after 1 week.
Yeah. Thank you. Thank you.
Yeah.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Sir, if you may, Professor, my humble insight is the world of the future, or the new world order, India should take the lead. So in one way, India could take the lead in the new world order is giving exemplary leadership examples, you know, in every aspect, political, business, economic, social, and the way we manage the pandemic or whatsoever it is. So I believe leaders of the Indian community from India should help global leaders to manage or to lead institutions and organizations. So we hope that one of the way India could lead the world or the new world order is by showing exemplary leadership, excellent leadership talents, and also ways. That's my suggestion, sir.
Okay. Yes, it is a very excellent observation on the point. And now we can move to the next point, next item.
Okay. So now let me now invite the Vice President of Kandalush Sabha, Sri Madhavan Nambudiri, who is a retired chief engineer from the government of Kerala, to present the citation to our distinguished guest, Professor Panduranga Bhatta.
Okay. Namaskar. Professor Dr. C. Panduranga Bhatta, who superannuated from the Indian Institute of Management, Calcutta in 2017, is a renowned Indologist and has contributed immensely to the field of Sanskrit studies for more than four decades. He has taught Indology and Sanskrit at postgraduate level and guided many MPhil and PhD students at the RKM Vivekananda College, Chennai and Pondicherry Central University. He has successfully applied Indology to management while teaching at the Indian Institute of Management, Calcutta for more than 20 years. He was the coordinator of Management Center for Human Values at the Indian Institute of Management, Calcutta, and the editor of the Journal of Human Values published by the Sage Publication. He has anchored books. He has authored books such as Display in Sanskrit Literature, 1985, Origin and Genesis of Chess, 1994, Contribution of Karnataka to Sanskrit in 1997, Introduction to Sanskrit Poetics in 2020, The Art of Leading in a Borderless World, along with Rajyan Rath, 2020, besides editing the book Pandit N.R. Bhatt Felicitation Volume, along with William Kat, P.S. And Narang, S.P. Motilal, Banarasi Das. The reputed Indological publisher will publish shortly his book on Dice Play and Origin of Chess in Sanskrit Literature. Professor Bhatta has published many research articles related to Indology, Sanskrit literature, Indian ethos and human values, creativity and innovation, leadership and business ethics in reputed journals issued from India and abroad. He has secured Jawaharlal Nehru Memorial Fund Award twice for the distinction achieved in academic fields, besides being honored with Devang Mehta Award in 2010 for Best Teacher in Business Ethics and Communication. He has also been honored with a gold medal by the Association of Indian Management Schools for securing the prestigious AIIMS-ICF at ICFAA Best Teacher Award 2011. He was deputed to ICCR Chair of Professor Sanskrit Silpakon University, Bangkok for two academic years by the Ministry of External Affairs, Government of India. After superannuation, he has founded Samanvaya Academy for Excellence, SAFE, for promoting human values in corporate sector and educational institution. He is an honorary advisor to Smartile, which is a startup company for creating artificial intelligence solutions for educational sector. Kandalur Shala offers its sincere gratitude and appreciation for his gracious presence and also delivering a lecture on inclusive leadership insights from Sanskrit literature as part of the National Lecture Series on Indian Knowledge Systems on 24th July 2021 on virtual platform. This citation is presented to Professor Dr. Sri Pandurenga Bhatta on Saturday, the 24th July 2021 at Thiruvananthapuram, Kerala, India. Thank you, sir.
And with the permission of the chair, let us conclude the session with Sandipada by your beloved President Narayana Puti.
Yes, yes, surely.
Namo Brahmane Namo Atmane Namo Prithvi Namo Oshadibhya Namo Vade Namo Vajaspadaye Namo Vishnave Brihade Karomi Namo Brahmane Namo Stupne Namo Prithvi Namo Oshadibhya Namo Vade Namo Vajaspadaye Namo Vishnave Brihade Karomi Namo Brahmane Namo Astvatnaye Namo Prithvi Namo Oshadibhyo Namo Vade Namo Vajaspadaye Namo Vishnave Brihade Karomi Om.
Namaste. Namaskaram to all, salutations to all. We will assemble next second Saturday of August. We will be talking on Vedic Vigris. It will be a lecture on wheels, Vedic epistemology, and exegesis lecture on these things. So that will be done on next second Saturday in the August. And the fourth Saturday, we have a great lecture by Dr. Mahadevan, who is a was former vice chancellor of Chinmaya University, and also at present he is a professor of IIM Bangalore, who will be speaking on marriage concepts. That too based on Sanskrit literature. So I invite you all, and we will be sending the communications in time, and we invite you all to participate in the program. Thank you.